Morning, everyone. Hope you're doing well. Grab a Bible, and I'm going to lead us in prayer. Father God, we do thank you that amidst all the challenges of this pandemic and through the weariness of lockdown, you are a God with a tender heart. You love us, you care for us, you want to look after us. And we thank you that as we turn to your word, you speak words of truth and words of life. And we pray that we might find life and strength and joy this morning as we look at these words now. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're looking at Epaphroditus yesterday and today, sent by the Philippians with a financial gift for Paul and his ministry, a brother, a fellow worker, a fellow soldier alongside Paul, someone who embodies the mindset of Christ in his concern for others. Now, he's been ill, but he's recovered, but the Philippians were worried about him. And Paul feels it's time to send him back to the Philippians, to his home church, so that they can see him again and be assured of his health. So let's read from verse 28, where Paul writes this: "Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad and I may have less anxiety. So then welcome him in the Lord with great joy and honour people like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ. He risked his life to make up for the help you yourselves could not give me." Welcome him in the Lord with great joy, says Paul, and honour people like him. Yesterday I mentioned our growth group leaders and others like them who are working so hard for the sake of others in our church, because we want to honour those who are enduring through hardship as they grow and encourage and make disciples amongst others. We want to honour those people. Well, it's the same with Epaphroditus, says Paul. We're told here he almost died for the work of Christ, so he's no stranger to the idea of sacrifice for the sake of others. He risked his life to make up for the help that the Philippians themselves were unable to provide. But what does Paul mean by that? It's a slightly odd word in this context, the word help. Why does Paul use it here? Well, it's usually translated elsewhere as religious service, as if one was talking about worship. And that, of course, begins to make sense, because for Epaphroditus, his whole life is one of worship. Under the Old Covenant, of course, worship, along with all the stuff we associate with it, sacrifice, prayer, adoration, praise, service, priest, all those kind of words, worship like that is all about the tabernacle and then later the temple. So we're in the Old Testament under the Old Covenant in that kind of thinking. It's all confined to a particular place. But we, of course, live now as Christians today under the New Covenant, in which the terminology of worship is much broader. It's not confined to the same sort of set of restrictions, if you like. So worship under the New Covenant isn't restricted to a Sunday service or taking communion or a public meeting or something like that. Instead, it's all of life and it's everywhere. Romans 12 in the New Testament captures it beautifully. Romans 12 and verse 1, Paul says to the Christians in Rome, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Indeed, in 1 Peter 5, verse 2, let me just look that up. We're told that Peter writes to these believers and speaks of them as a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So we no longer need priests anymore, because as Christians we believe and belong to the priesthood of all believers. That's what we believe in. So therefore, we don't need priests in the same way. There's lots more on that in the book of Hebrews. Or Romans 15, for example. In Romans 15, worship is bound up with evangelism. That is right at the heart of how we declare God's praise and worship him in life today, as we tell other people about Jesus. Speaking of Jesus, in John chapter 4, Jesus says that worship is something that embraces all of life in every location, in the conversation he has with the Samaritan woman. And so as we work that through, a church building is no more a place of worship, we might say, than a kitchen table as Dad leads the family in family prayer, or as Mum says grace at a mealtime, or indeed the office. Do you remember offices when we had them? You know, if ever you're allowed to go back into an office, worship is something that takes place in an office, when in the way that you speak, in the way that you behave, in the way that you think about career and ambition and all of those things, instead of living for self-promotion and self-advancement, the way of the world, you live for the glory of God. Even if it means you have to give something up, even if it costs you. Now, let me be really clear here. None of this is to denigrate the unique and profound significance of corporate worship and what happens when we gather together as a church family on a Sunday for worship. That is something unique, it is something very powerful, it is something that has a very special place in our life together. Sundays are special, we don't want to miss them. God does something, is doing something, and speaks to us in a very profound way when we gather together. So we always want to be careful when we say that worship is something that takes place everywhere, that we don't water down Sunday to just being just another location and just another thing. No, Sundays are special. But we don't have time to get into all of that now. That's for another day. For today, we have a reminder here that worship is all of life lived in response to the grace of God. And we are either living for God in everything or we are not. There is no halfway house. And that's where Epaphroditus is so helpful, because there was nothing half-hearted about his commitment. He was all in for the sake of the gospel. He risked his whole life. Indeed, he almost died in order to serve Jesus Christ. It wasn't just a few hours in the week. It was all of life in every location. And Paul says we should honour people like him. So let's pray that as we follow his example, we might offer ourselves, all of us, in everything, everywhere, to God in worship. Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you for the example of Epaphroditus, who risked his life and almost died for the work of Christ. Father, we thank you for the way in which he was all in for Jesus Christ and his church. And we want to pray that in response to what you have done for us in Christ through the gospel, we want to pray that we would give ourselves, our whole lives, in worship. In whatever we're doing today, in whatever we're about to do, at home or at work, in our community, wherever it is, would you help us to give ourselves in worship for Jesus? Amen.